Okay, welcome everyone that's here with us in council chambers and those that are viewing from home. This is the meeting of the city council for June 10th, 2013. And if we could all rise, I have an invocation and use the Pledge of Allegiance. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and for the many blessings you've bestowed on our city. Tonight, I want to thank you for our citizens. Our citizens who volunteer, our citizens who make us the city that we are. And for this council, Lord, thank you for their leadership and their guidance. Please look out for our soldiers, our sailors, our airmen, our guardsmen as they serve in foreign lands, and also watch over our public safety employees as they protect each of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I think we've got a meeting full of fun tonight, a lot of items on the agenda, a lot of public hearings. So I'm getting ready to open the audience for visitors, and what I would like to reinforce is that if you're here to speak on one of the public hearings, there will be an additional time to speak to those one at a time. However, this is an open audience for visitors, and if you would like to address council on any subject that's not on the agenda this evening, now is that time. Okay, seeing none, I'll close the audience for visitors, and I'll ask for the approval of the minutes.
Mayor, I move that we approve the minutes of our regular meeting of June 10th, 2013.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded that we approve the minutes of the regular session, June 10th. Questions or comments? Not Judy, please.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Vernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, thank you very much. And now we move into the public hearings section. And the first public hearing is a request by the City of Pocosin, being the property owner, and Bradford Drummond. This is the applicant for a conditional use permit to construct and establish an outdoor laser tag park on property located on south side of Victory Boulevard, currently zoned R&D. And I don't know, are you going to combine this with item two, or have we got to hold each of these separately?
These two can be combined.
Okay, these two can be combined. All right. Randy, is there somebody to give a staff presentation?
Kevin is here, and you did a pretty good job of summarizing it, but he may have a point or two to add in, and it would be useful to put up the map so that folks could see the issue, and then Kevin will outline the conditional use permit suggestions as terms of the conditions. Go ahead, Mr. Wine.
All right. The city has received a request from Mr. and Mrs. Brad Drummond, the owners of Tag Time Laser, or Tag Time LLC, I believe, to operate a laser tag park on an 18.5-acre parcel located in the Big Woods south of Victory Boulevard. It's a city-owned parcel. It is currently zoned research and development, R&D. A use of this nature is not permitted by right anywhere in the city. So with that being said, in accordance with Article 1, Section 1-8 of the Zoning Ordinance, if in any district established under this ordinance, a use is not specifically permitted for, an application can be made for a conditional use permit. So that's why we are here tonight. They are asking for a use permit to operate the specialized use. The applicant is proposing to use the 18.5-acre parcel as an outdoor laser tag park. No permanent structures are planned for this property at this time. The bathrooms will consist of a portable, self-contained, frequently serviced trailer building at this time, is my understanding. 50 to 75 parking spots will be provided on a pervious surface, more than likely a gravel surface of some type. The business will cater to weekend guests during the daylight hours and anticipates approximately 500 guests during a typical Saturday or Sunday. The business plan plans to host corporate, military, and private clients less frequently during daylight weekday hours. The site is incredibly large and has 350 feet of frontage on the southern side of Victory Boulevard. And while the property is that large, only a small portion of it is uplands. The majority of it is wetlands and likely cannot be used, according to a preliminary wetlands assessment that the city conducted on the property within the last year and a half or so. A passive recreation use of this nature that will not require a lot of improvements, specifically permanent improvements, is permitted within wetlands areas, as long as they're keeping underbrush and things of that nature. And a use of this nature requires little support from permanent structures. The Planning Commission unanimously recommended this application for approval at their June 17th meeting. However, they did propose that a 12th condition be added. This condition is pertaining to the traffic impact. A use of this nature is quite unique. Probably the closest thing, and I don't like to compare it to this, but a paintball outdoor use of that nature, probably similar traffic impact. However, really no traffic studies have been completed for uses of this nature. So they added this 12th condition that after a 12-month period or before the 12-month period ends, that a traffic impact assessment be conducted and given to the city. Due to the uniqueness of the site and the existence of ample naturally forested buffers, staff supports the approval of this application as well, provided that the following conditions be met. The hours of operation shall be limited to 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. daily. Any permanent buildings are erected that they receive ARB approval. All utilities shall be placed underground. All storage of equipment aside from licensed vehicles shall be stored in an enclosed structure. Upon the discontinuance of such use for a contiguous period of 2 years or more, the conditional use permit shall become null and void. All trash receptacles shall be screened from adjacent properties and right-of-ways. A naturally forested 40-foot buffer shall be maintained between the site's parking area and Victory Boulevard. A naturally forested 50-foot buffer shall be maintained between the playing fields and all adjacent properties, with the playing fields not extending into this buffer. Playing fields shall be located no closer than 150 feet to Victory Boulevard and shall be screened from public view by natural forest. This use permit shall be used solely for the establishment of a laser tag use and shall not be interpreted for use of a like business. Any other use not specifically permitted within the property zoning district shall require a separate use permit. Outdoor storage shall be prohibited. And lastly, the Planning Commission added condition, a traffic study shall be conducted within 12 months after the business opens. So that is all on this application. I can answer any questions you have. Additionally, Mr. Drummond is in the audience and he would be willing to answer any you have as well.
Some questions of council?
I have a few.
Okay.
I was looking at the list of requirements that we wanted to add to it with, you know, the, how many do we have, 12 recommendations? And I think we might be putting an undue burden on ourselves and the business. I'll start with number one, the hours of operation, limiting them from 7 to 10 p.m. I know that laser tag works best in the dark, and I would think that on weekends, letting people have, you know, I know that some, there are some activities such as this where they allow sleepovers. So I would not see what the problem would be with that, or at least keeping it open until midnight or 1 if they wanted to do that. So I don't know why we're limiting to those hours. Number two, approval of the Architectural Review Board on the building. I don't know why we would want to go through a board process when we could just allow the city manager to do that. Number three, it says all utilities must be placed underground. We're dealing with a lot of wetlands there, so I'm not so sure that it would be wise to put some, you know, electric or cable or stuff that might not be best served to be underground. I didn't have problems with 4, 5, and 6. Number 7 and 8, we're making them retain a naturally forested buffer between the parking area and Victory Boulevard. I would think that if we have a business, we would want at least the parking area to be visible from Victory so that people coming to it would be able to see it. 50-foot buffer maintained between the fields and the adjacent properties. On the map, that's not what the yellow line is it? The yellow line is 50 feet?
No, the yellow line is the outline of the property.
But it doesn't indicate how deep into it 50 feet is.
It's the property on the portion on Victory Boulevard is roughly 350 feet wide, and it gets wider.
So the yellow line is it would be that or less of the buffer?
The yellow line's the property line. Okay. As far as the 50 feet.
My question is 50-foot buffer. I think that seems pretty big. I don't know why we want to do that either. If they're shooting paintballs, sure, I would see it. And that's another question, I would allow paintball. That would be my inclination if they wanted to transition into that as well. I know we're going to talk about pneumatic guns later on, which I have issues with, but we'll get to that. It talks about the playing fields not being visible to the public. Again, why? And then number 12, I really think is especially difficult. We know traffic studies can cost quite a bit of money, and it says it must be conducted. Well, I think leaving the option of, if necessary, you know, if the city feels like we need a traffic study done, it would be reasonable to do it then, but I don't see the laser tag people getting more traffic than we do here at City Hall. So I think that I just don't want to put any burdens on. If we're trying to be business friendly, this feels like a lot of burden to me. So those are my comments.
I think those are all valid.
I was going to suggest that we change the wording of number 12. I agree with this. Traffic study seems kind of silly. These things are going to be timed, and the traffic's going to show up. If yours is at 12 o'clock, it's going to show up between 11:30 and 4 to 12 or 5 to 12. And they're going to leave, and the next group comes in. I don't really see a tremendous traffic problem.
So why don't we just
change it to only if a problem is perceived by staff?
Why don't we just scratch 12?
I'd say scratch it all.
Because what would we do if the traffic study said something? I mean, you've had the business invest their money, so now what are you going to do? Either you do it before or you don't do it.
Right.
I mean, that's the thing. All right, so let's scratch 12. I think we've got a consensus there. Okay. First, are there any other questions of council for Kevin?
I just had one that seemed to be some conflict in some of the statements. No permanent structures are allowed, but then it references the fact that things have to be stored inside. If there's no structure, how are you going to store it inside? It seems to be...
Well, at this time, they're not planning for any permanent structures. We're looking, we're thinking ahead a little bit. If they do expand, if they do keep anything on the property as storage, that it be enclosed. So at that time, they would require a permanent structure, and they'd be able to do that accordingly on the site.
Okay.
Kevin, if you could, and you may have mentioned this, other 18 acres approximately for the folks that are watching this that think that's such a big piece of property, mm-hmm. How much of that is wetlands as a percentage?
As a percentage, it's probably about 80% wetlands. And it's three small pockets. They're not even connected. One is about a 250-foot deep area right at Victory Boulevard. The other is on the City Hall Avenue side of that, somewhere in the middle of that parcel, and then the other one is in that bottom southeastern quadrant. Very small area.
I assume there's no problem with parking with a pervious surface if it happens to be a wetland?
Well, they're hoping that they can't put a parking surface in a wetland area.
Okay.
They have identified that little area at the front there where they should be able to sneak a parking lot in, hopefully. Like I said, at this time, we have a preliminary wetlands assessment. We don't have a certified delineation yet.
Okay.
You think there'll be enough rotation that the 50 to 75 parking spaces can accommodate the numbers of persons?
That's 10 people per car.
Yeah, we're hopeful of the traffic that they're talking about on the weekends. You're talking waves of activity, and a lot of times with a use like this, people will carpool together. So with the 50 to 70 foot, Mr. Drummond's quite confident that that'll be sufficient. And from a staff level, we're quite confident as well.
Okay, any other questions? All right, I think what I've heard, and I would agree that council's concerned about some of the recommendations for things, and I think we'll talk about those in detail after the public hearing if everybody's okay. We'll kind of go through those one by one.
Right, and Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to add a few things. The buffer requirement for the parking lot is a zoning ordinance requirement.
Okay.
So that's more of a redundancy. So is the ARB requirement.
Well, we count on you to keep us keep us from going too far. But
okay.
I would just say the general comment is we want to make sure that
if
we approve this, and that's an if, that it would be a viable business and not over encumbered by stuff we put on it. Okay.
Thank you.
So with that said, this is a public hearing. And basically, anybody who is interested in addressing council on the subject, now is that time. And that would include if Mr. Drummond or anybody else wants to speak. So I'll open the public hearing, and it looks like you're ready to go. So we'll let you start.
Good evening. I'm Brad Drummond. My wife and I are the owners of Tag Time Laser Tag. And Tag Time was founded about 4 years ago. As a mobile business. So we do everything from backyard birthday parties to corporate events, school events, church events, stuff like that. We have a pretty good presence in Pecosin, and on any given weekend, we can be found in somebody's backyard or at a church or somewhere doing an event, whether it be birthday parties or family reunions or those types of things. Essentially, Heather and I have three boys. We all enjoyed laser tag. It was a family activity that we all enjoyed. And when we found that we could combine that with our love for the outdoors and do outdoor laser tag, it just seemed something that was very fitting. So our growth has basically led us to this point where we've been looking for a permanent location. We, like I said, do all mobile activities now, but are looking for something to call home and expand on. And the Big Woods property, very unique piece of land, a lot of wetlands out there. But the good thing about our business is we can tailor our activity around those areas, preserve the wetlands, and use the upland areas that are out there. So, and with that said, we're really excited about bringing laser tag to Pecosin. So, thank you all.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Drummond. Anyone else would like to address council on this issue? Okay, seeing none, I will close the public hearing and ask for consideration by council. And I would suggest that we first step through, see if we can gain a consensus on the recommendations here. And Kevin, you keep us straight, all right? Okay. But Councilwoman Crawford started out with a concern about item one. Which is hours of operation.
7 to 10. Is it okay with, would you all agree to extend that maybe to midnight? I mean,
I have no problem
with that. Just scrap. I don't know if we, is it required that we stipulate their hours of operation?
I would go more with that.
Yeah. Let's scratch one.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Scratch it.
Yeah.
And Kev, do you mind if I go on, since they were my thoughts? Approval of the Architectural Review Board. Kevin, you're saying we cannot scratch that because it's, or it's, since it's already in the city code, we could scratch it.
It's required.
Kevin. As hold on a minute. Kevin, come to the microphone so folks at home can hear you.
Okay.
As the ordinance is written now, properties within the Research and Development District and General Commercial District and Village Commercial District are required, any permanent improvements must go before the ARB.
So this is basically a duplication of that?
So it's a redundancy, yes. So it could be scratched, but they would still be required to go before the ARB.
We'll scratch that.
As well as number seven.
I'm looking for consensus here as we go on. I'm not hearing any. Not hearing any.
Can we scratch number seven as well?
Well, let's, okay. You said something about number three.
Oh, yes, I did. All utilities must be placed underground. I just worry about the logistics of that and as well as cost. I like my utilities underground, but if we're dealing with 80% wetlands.
I think that.
With modern technology, Tracy Dale, they can bore those electricity, gas, they can all be bored. They won't disturb any ground at all except for where they need to end it and start it. So I don't think that's a real issue.
And it won't be a cost prohibitive issue?
No, either? They do it all the time. They'd rather do that.
That was
they
really
don't want to open cut it.
Okay.
Okay, so we're going to leave three.
That's fine. That was just a question. Then getting down to number seven, I believe there's also a redundancy in the city code. Is that correct, Kevin?
Yes.
So we can, I would like to scratch seven.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Just so that I'm processing correctly. If you choose to scratch it, that doesn't mean the requirement actually goes
correct.
Away.
Right. Correct.
Okay. We don't want to restate the ordinance here, because if the ordinance changes for some reason or another, then
10-4.
All right.
Yes.
I'm going to make sure we were clear.
Okay. All right. You had a concern about eight?
Number eight. I was just thinking, I don't know why or where or if we really want that.
Here's a question for you, Kevin.
All right.
There's something back in here that says that you can't expand these uses. So they can't expand into paintball without coming for an additional.
Yes. Yes.
They couldn't expand into going into a batting cage operation or any other outdoor recreation without revisiting us?
I would have to look at the code more specifically on batting cage or something of that, or a mini golf, but I'm fairly confident those would require separate conditional use permits.
Okay. So if this is only for laser tag, then I just want to make sure we were clear on that. All right. So, Council, what's your druthers on this one?
Well, since we already have it in the code that the parking lot's got to be 40 feet, why don't we just simplify it and make it all 40 feet? I mean, I don't see the problem with having a game 40 feet from somebody's property or 40 feet from Victory Boulevard, as far as that goes.
Right, so 8 and 9,
just
yes.
Make them all 40 feet.
Okay.
So we're making number 8 and number 9 40 feet?
That's what I'm hearing.
Yes.
Okay. And now, what about the playing fields screened from public view by natural forest? I don't like that at all.
I think that's up to the operator of the business, personally.
Yeah.
You know.
I'd scratch number 9 entirely.
What are y'all's druthers on this one?
Well, I'd like to know, is this laser of such low intensity that it's visible?
Okay.
I mean, if you cleared that area and they're shooting it out on the highway.
Yeah, it's actually infrared. There is no laser. The actual targeting beam and everything is infrared, so it's essentially no different than a TV remote control. So it's totally eye safe, no.
So you don't see anything.
Right.
I don't have a problem with scratching.
And I've never participated in this kind of activity. I know absolutely nothing. There's no particular noise.
No. No, very, very little, people essentially
yell,
like
other than somebody yell a holler. And from down there, nobody is going to hear you in a resident anyway, I would think. Mm-hmm. And for about how long, I was talking about parking earlier, I don't know, do you run it for like 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours?
Typically a 2 hour, typically like a birthday party is the majority of our business is a 2 hour event. And so we typically would roll customers at that hour and a half to 2 hour mark.
Okay.
Well, if it's okay with council, we'll take a second vote and see if we can elect to have a game with the vice mayor who's never played this before.
Us against him?
We need a retreat.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, a retreat.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. So that takes us to.
So are we scratching 9?
sounded like.
This, the screen part, right?
Yeah, the screen part.
We're gonna leave it at 40 feet.
I don't care where the fields are myself, but if you want to stretch. 40
feet.
Screen, shall be screened.
It shall be screened. Okay. All right, and then item 10, I think we're okay with, and it's basically the precursor to why we've done a lot of stuff here. So 11?
11 was okay. Did we agree to scratch 12 already?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. The only other thing I would, I say in jest, but partially seriously, no other use permitted. It might be a good location to also add a mosquito control business. But that would be permitted within rights. Is that correct? Okay. Just thinking forward.
Okay. So if a motion were to come out with the the directives of the Planning Commission modified as agreed, that would be okay, so we don't have to go through each one of those. Judy, have you got those all annotated?
I think so. You're taking out number 1, 2, and 7, and 12 entirely, right?
Yes.
Yes, right.
And then number 9, you're saying 40 feet and stop at Shelby Screened.
No.
Just strike that.
Sabbath Boulevard.
It stops at Boulevard.
Oh, okay, gotcha. Okay, and then everything else stays.
And number 8 was amended to reflect 40 rather than 50.
40 feet.
Right, okay, all right.
Okay.
Then I got it.
Yep. And do we not want to permit paintball as well by right, since we're here? Or, well, he has no intent anyway.
I think we just go with it like it is.
Look forward to seeing you again if you decide to branch out.
Now, Mr. Moore, did we violate anything?
No.
Thank you. Kevin, you good? Thank you. All right. With that said, is there a motion by council?
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution approving a conditional use permit for an outdoor laser tag park on property located on the south side of Victory Boulevard, identified as tax map parcel number 27-01-00-0001, with the exceptions of what the council agreed upon.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded that we approve the request.
Okay. So I'll leave it at that.
Questions or final comments?
Thank you.
All right. Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Thank you very much. All right, so the next public hearing I am going to combine, and these are what's on the agenda for the evening is items 2 and 3, and this is a request by Wave Communities Pocosin LLC, property owner, to amend the city's comprehensive plan for tax map parcel 1801-00-0075 from B2 to R3 multifamily residential. And 3, the request for Wave Properties LLC owner to rezone approximately 3.79 acres or the same tract, 1801-00-0075 from B2 to R3 multifamily residential. And this is property located adjacent to 498 With Creek Road. Kevin, are you doing this presentation as well? You are the man, so right on up.
All right. Back in March, our department was approached by Mr. Bobby Willis, the owner of Wave Properties and Cool Wave Car Wash, who was interested in the property behind where the Cool Wave Car Wash is currently being constructed. That track is a 3.7 acre property directly behind that serviced by Firth Lane, which is technically a private drive right now. We have two requests in front of us tonight, and this first one is the precursor, and to make sure that everyone in the audience and at home understands, the first one is a redesignation of land use. It's changing the city's future land use map. are slightly different than a zoning change in the fact that in the zoning and in the comp plan, everything that's business related is called general commercial. Presently, this property is designated as general commercial. From a zoning standpoint, it's designated B2. Also, the property owner wishes to designate it in the comp plan to high density residential, which is our R3 zoning district, but we'll get to that second. This is the property. You can see right here, it's almost kind of a wedge shape there off of Firth Lane. It sits approximately, I believe, 200 feet off of With Creek Road and is immediately behind. There's an apartment complex there, and the Cool Wave will be sitting in front of it. Here's, you probably can't see that too well at home, but this is the survey of the parcel. Like I said, it's about 3.75 acres. The applicant is proposing to change the property's future land use as designation from general commercial to high density residential. The high density residential designation allows for 12 dwelling units per acre. Ultimately, and I'll get into more of this during the rezoning, but the property owner is requesting, has proposed a concept to construct 24 townhome units on the property. This is currently the future land use map. You can see in purple there, it's designated as general commercial. Across the street there and behind the post office, you can see our highest concentration of high density residential, which includes With Creek Apartments, Town Villas North and South, among the other townhome communities there. The property has approximately 50 feet of frontage, on With Creek Road and widens to over 350 feet at its widest middle and rear portions. The property consists of 3.78 acres. Three-quarters of the property is surrounded by developed single-family properties. This includes a large portion around Islander Way, Hudgens, and some properties that go as far to Pocosin Avenue. The property is heavily forested at this time. You can kind of see that if you go to the site where the Cool Wave property is cleared. A little bit of that forest is actually on the Cool Wave property. So this property is completely forested. The property currently has an active conditional use permit for a mini storage warehouse facility on the property. So that has not been revoked and is still potential. Staff findings. The location of the property lends itself incredibly favorably to a change in use. I say this because it's set back so far from With Creek Road. It's about 350 feet there, I believe, or 200 feet. And it would have limited visibility once the car wash goes up from With Creek Road, which is something that's not necessarily favorable to a business use. The property is surrounded by single-family development to its northeast and south. This changing the land use designation would allow a natural transition from a high-impact business corridor to a lower-impact single-family residential district. For the reasons I just stated, staff is recommending approval of this application, as did the Planning Commission at their meeting unanimously by a vote of 4-0. That being said, I can answer any questions you have about this. We're going right into the rezoning, yeah, I believe.
Right to the one, we'll ask questions all at one time.
Okay. So that was the first proposal. That was a land use change from general commercial to high density residential. This is a rezoning request for a change from B2 business commercial district to R3 multifamily. The purpose of this request, like I briefly mentioned earlier, was to construct a 24-unit townhome development on the property, the concept which I'm about to show. The density that it would yield, a development of this nature, is 6.34 units per acre. And per the comp plan as well as the zoning ordinance, a use of this nature would be permitted to yield 12 units per acre. So he's at about half of that. Here's, as I mentioned, this is the zoning map. You can see the different colors there. That red is the B2 district. the orange there is the R1, which is kind of our medium density residential. And across the street at Valasia and Bell's Cove, you can see that brown, which is multifamily, R3. Here's the concept that was given to us sometime earlier this year, stated March 5th. This is the general concept at this time. The property owner would like to turn Firth Lane into a public road and have it accepted into our VDOT system. This is the general layout, 24 units. Screening requirements would be provided in accordance with our R3 ordinance language. Very similar to the reasons we're supporting the land use designation change, we're supporting this change as well. It's set back so far off of With Creek Road, it doesn't provide a business really due frontage. Additionally, it offers a natural transition. I know I would prefer to live next to a townhome development than, say, a mini storage warehouse or a box store. The Planning Commission also agreed with this, and at their meeting, they unanimously approved it by a vote of 4-0. So with that being said, I can answer any questions you may have.
Questions of council? Kevin.
I'm assuming the Planning Commission did not add any stipulations to this. Were any stipulations discussed?
They did not, no.
I have a question, Kevin. Looking at the map, the survey map that was presented, it shows parcel in the front, 9/10 acre, B, parcel B2. Will the rezoning line follow the property line? If you, there is clearly a rear property line on the parcel B2, but then the property sort of to the left of the parcel, there's a small piece there, which would, I assume, be rezoned to R3 just to make sure we get the property line in the right place. You don't have some of the R3 on the B2 and some of the B2 on the R3.
Yes, absolutely. It would follow
that property line, so it would be consistent. So it would not be a straight line across the back. It's going to be a jog in that line.
Yes, there would be a jog in that line. I believe what road is it? It's a gravel road. Okay, that's Firth Lane going back. So yes, it would follow that property line.
Okay.
And you say Firth Lane will become a public right-of-way?
That's the hope that Mr. Willis is proposing to do that as of now.
So that basically means a VDOT standard road,
mm-hmm.
right?
And the right-of-way is there now.
Well, I think that's important for access for emergency services and the like. So it's,
also,
I would almost say it's a pre-crime.
Also,
I would almost
so
say
we'll
it would
paid
be
the lane miles from
right.
VDOT.
Well, it's
we
important for
it.
Both, but I think it's if we're going to allow a lot of folks back here, we want to make sure that we've provided that we'll have true access, not an asphalt or a gravel road at some point in time. So I almost think it ought to be a requirement. So just something to consider
yeah.
as we move forward.
I had a similar question. Well, two actually. One, how much time or what sort of notification do we have to give the public for this? Is this it, and then we vote on it another time? Is this, or do we vote on it now and this is it?
This is a public hearing.
This is the public hearing, and we can move either way the council would like.
All right, because I personally would feel more comfortable. I don't think anybody really knew about this, so I would be more comfortable putting it out there publicly louder before we voted to change the.
Well, let's hear from the public first before
yeah,
we make that.
I would like to.
There's a lot of people here, and I don't know what they're here to talk about. They could be here to talk about the mayor.
There's soccer
and
players.
And that would be okay. All right. Any other questions of council? All right. Thank you, Kevin, again. And if we ask you a question, just come to the mic. All right. So with that said, we'll open the public hearing on both the redo of the comprehensive plan for land use, and as well as any questions particular to or comments on the rezoning proper from B2 to R3, or from business to multifamily residential. And I think the one thing, Kevin, that you didn't talk about, I want to make sure the public hears this, is what's proposed to us is 6 units per acre. And Kevin, correct me if I'm wrong, what is our multifamily residential limit?
12.
It is 12. That's what I thought I remembered. So you're considerably less than the high density that the district allows. Right? Okay. All right. All right. With that said, I'll open the public hearing. Anybody would like to speak? Yes, sir. And to help, Judy, if y'all could please state your name and your address, so that'd be very helpful. So
we good have evening. My name is Bobby Willis. I'm the owner of Wave Properties Pocosin. To answer your question, we had a community meeting. We sent out flyers to all the surrounding property owners. Let me find the actual meeting notes. We had the on 7 p.m. Thursday, May the 9th, we had the chambers here, and we opened it up to the public and sent out notices weeks in advance to all the surrounding property owners. And we talked with everyone then about any concerns that they may have about the project.
How many people came?
Maybe 15.
Out of how many notices did you send out?
Probably 25.
Okay.
Yeah, so we had a pretty good turnout. And I've made myself readily available to anyone. I've given out my cards to people that had any concerns over anything.
Okay.
Just a little bit about me and what I do. I actually own the property. It's not something that I'm looking to purchase. I purchased it when I purchased the property for the car wash. And I do projects in different localities. I've done projects down on the Outer Banks. I own car washes in Newport News and Smithfield. I have projects currently going over Gloucester, looking at some stuff over in Suffolk. I've done projects in Hampton, California, different places. And what I do is I look at the highest and best use for a piece of property. I don't go in and just try to, you know, put as much stuff on it as I can. For instance, this property, I'm asking for it to be rezoned to R3, which would allow for 45 units on this piece of property. And I don't see that on this property. You know, it's not something for 45 units. So what I've done is I've worked with my engineering group, and we've found something that I feel is suitable for the community, something that's not overpowering. I mean, something that's, you know, will be a good neighbor for the community. And that's what I do. I'm looking at putting this in, and it's not going to be, you know, something that's lower income. I'm looking for something that's going to be, you know, higher income, a nice project. A couple of questions that came up during the meetings with the homeowners was talking about the stormwater pond. The stormwater pond was actually sized for the car wash and for the self-storage unit that there currently is a conditional use permit for. And that had 90% impervious area. So the stormwater pond is actually oversized for the community that I'm proposing here. And we've had some other requests. I have a company coming in. They were supposed to do it 2 weeks ago, but some reeds and things have grown up on the sides of the pond. I mean, I've signed the maintenance agreement for the pond, and I actually have a company scheduled to come in to clean that out. Their excuse for not doing it as of yet is the weather. They didn't want to tear up the banks, you know, getting their equipment in there, so they wanted to let it dry out a little more than what it is. But I told them it has to be done, so it's going to be done shortly, even if they have to get in there and take care of it by hand. Talking about Firth Lane, you brought up a point. I want to bring that roadway in there up to VDOT standards for like you said, and then turn it over to the city. So I'm willing to spend the money to do that. I don't see, you know, just a little driveway back in there to support this. I go in, I do things first class, so that's what I want to do. I want to bring it up to VDOT standards and then turn it over to the city. I mean, it's a significant expense for me, but I'm willing to do that.
And those side streets going off that house that have the houses, those would not be city, correct?
No, those are private driveways. And as you see, the little turnouts there on the back, we did that to allow so fire trucks could get in there and turn around if they need to, or emergency vehicles. So, I mean, this is just not something that I threw together. I mean, there's a lot of hours in the planning of what's on the paper there. Some of the other questions that I had is, you know, exactly what I'm proposing is they're three-bedroom, two-and-a-half-bath units with a single-car garage. As of today, I mean, I really haven't had any concerns from surrounding property owners. I mean, they brought up a few things during the meeting, but nothing that really stands out.
Was all
drainage-related, I'm sure. Yeah. And it is something that I'm a good neighbor to have. You know, I've worked with Mr. Creasy on his parking for Pocosin Pharmacy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just something like me, how I operate is I actually shut down the car wash project for a couple of weeks because we ran into some utilities that weren't marked on the property that weren't in an easement. Well, I could have went back to the homeowners around me and asked for them to pay for it. I mean, it's costing me about $10,000 to relocate these utilities. But I didn't go to the homeowners on this. It's just something I'm going to do. I'm a good neighbor. I'm going to do it the right way. And, you know, I'm not going to stir anything up. I'm developing the property, and I'm doing it the right way. So, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Anybody else that would like to speak on this subject?
Council? Ron Sperling. I live on 102 Firth Lane. First of all, I'm not opposed to this project going on. Mr. Willis has been very agreeable. The only thing I want to say is that the engineering map that's been shown is outdated by about 7 years. There is a large retention pond in there on that piece of property. There is a 50-foot ingress and egress easement on that property. And of course, there are setbacks and wetlands. So I think if you subtract all of that out, the property that can be built on is much smaller than 3.7 acres. So I would at least take that in consideration. With the car wash and 24 units, that is going to be a very tight little area to get in and out of.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am. We'll wait for you. Yeah. Take that.
Hi, I'm Lee Evans, 15 Hudgens Road. And of all the things that have been offered on the property to date, this would be the one that would be best for residential. It was residential. Back in the 70s, it was rezoned commercial without the neighboring people knowing that it even happened. We were not even notified. And I just feel like this is more residential friendly. Mr. Willis has been very accommodating with the cool, you know, the car wash and trying to make things, you know, nobody wants business, you know, up against them. But when you live in an area that's been rezoned, then, you know, there are things. But my husband and I just feel like this is a better use of the property.
Yes, ma'am.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Hello, Jesse Dunlap. I got 93 First Lane. So we're looking at the car wash and would be looking at the new proposed development as much as anybody. I think aside from a multi-mini storage place, that this would be leaps and bounds better. So, I mean, I would encourage for that. I understand the other concerns as far as, you know, you look at things where if we're going to encourage natural buffers on highways like Victory, I think you should encourage natural buffers for residential backyards a little bit. And that's not necessarily even a concern I have for my front yard looking at it, so much as it is for everybody else who would be a little more adjacent to the property. The fact that he's advocating for a VDOT confirmation of that road and to be able to use, I think that that's a great selling point on his part as far as getting the approval, especially if he's willing to incur that expense on himself. And then turn it over to the city, to VDOT, basically. Only thing I would have is concerns are is basically just curb and gutter for those who are back there. I know that's a pretty preliminary plan of what's there, but as far as everybody who uses that as an ingress, egress, you know, I run a home business from my location there. So you know, to be able to have that curb and gutter and everybody be able to access through that newly developed VDOT road. Obviously, in his plan, it's, you know, it's well landscaped and everything else like that. So, I mean, I think is, you know, just from a beautification standpoint, it's better than the, it's as good or better than the 30-foot tall pile of dirt that's there now and whatever else. So, you know, I would support it. I'd still like to see a more fleshed out plan as far as the ingress egress road. And we were the beneficiaries of some of that utilities. We lost our water and our plumbing and Verizon for a little while, but they were pretty quick on getting that fixed. So, you know, as far as, you know, just making sure that all those were addressed to where we didn't have, because everybody back there is on a grinder pump. So to make sure that we weren't underneath 5 foot of newly developed VDOT certified roads, if we ever did have an issue with something, would be my only concerns there. But other than that, I mean, I understand the other homeowners concerned as far as it being fairly densely populated once you take into account the drainage ponds, the new roads and all that. But from a impervious standpoint, not being really on any wetlands and stuff there, you know, I think that, you know, he's on the line as far as what would be an acceptable number of units. But,
okay.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. And just for everyone's information, the approval on this would be done on basically on a preliminary plan. There's a lot of details to work through. So, and as is always, the devil's sometimes in the details and trying to make sure that everything lines up. But what we don't do normally is put somebody through a detailed plan and then say, oh, guess what, we won't even change the zoning. So you certainly appreciate the comments on the details, and all of those will get factored into staff's review of that. But we're not at that level of plan yet, but I do appreciate the comments. All right, anyone else? Okay. Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and ask for consideration by council.
Mr. Mayor, I do have one question of Mr. Willis, if I could. Have you gotten to the point yet where you have a ballpark selling price for these units?
As these costs continue to arise, you know, no, I'm, one thing that I do when I evaluate properties is I analyze them to death. And, you know, factoring in for underground utilities and, you know, all the curbing and guttering and turning over the city to VDOT standards. I'm looking probably in the $260,000 to $300,000 range for the units now. I mean, that may go up depending on cost of lumber and everything. I mean, by the time we factor in all the engineering costs and everything, I mean, I already have a substantial amount in the property already. I mean, just everything that's going on. So,
okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have a question. How large are these units, roughly? I'm not sure if it says on.
I think they're roughly around 1,700 square feet.
Okay. Thanks.
And that's just one particular unit that I've been
looking at.
You know, I've done several different sizes.
Right.
I just look for a good flow, you know, with downstairs masters and things. So,
absolutely.
You know, for an older community.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I am an adjacent property owner to this. So in order to alleviate any open door of conflict, I'll recuse myself on the vote.
Okay. All right. Would you like to speak publicly on as an adjacent property owner? I'm just kidding, Henry. It's okay.
I already did.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution approving an amendment to the future land use maps of the city's adopted comprehensive plan of 2008 to 2028.
Second.
A motion made and seconded that we approve the. Are you doing both?
No, just the first one.
Okay. All right, the redo of the comprehensive plan. Motion made and seconded. Questions or comments by council?
There will be a wetland study at some point on this. But it doesn't have to be now.
That is part of the site development
process.
That's
part of the, that's what I thought. Okay. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Another, Judy, please.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
And are you recusing yourself, Councilman Ayer?
Yeah.
Mayor Hunt?
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 5-0 with one recused from both.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution approving the rezoning of 3.79 acres of property located adjacent to 498 with Creek Road, the Coastal Tax Map, parcel number 18-01-00-0075.
Thank you, Senator, really well. Is there a second on that?
A second. Yeah. There needs to be a correction in section 2. The date's wrong. It's March, should be March 5th, 2013, not 2013.
Can I ask one thing before? I'm sorry, go ahead. Are you done, Wayne? I'm sorry.
I was going to say, and I didn't know if you wanted to include a section 3 relative to Firth Lane being dedicated to the public.
That's right where I was coming back to.
Yeah. I'd like to amend my motion, Mr. Mayor, to change the date in section 2 to 2013, March the 5th. And in section 3 to add a condition that Firth Lane be built to VDOT standards.
Okay.
Modify the second to agree to that.
You agree with the amended motion. Got it. All right. Questions or comments of council? All right. Seeing none, Judy, please.
Councilman Green?
Aye.
Councilman Bernal?
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman?
Aye.
Mayor Hunt?
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 5-0.
Okay, thank you very much. All right. The next public hearing. This is an ordinance amending Article 11, the Village Commercial District, of the zoning ordinance pertaining to front yard area requirements. Kevin, are you also the man on this?
Four-time winner.
this is more of a housekeeping measure.
That's fine.
And it's striking one section in Article 11 of the zoning ordinance pertaining to Village Commercial District development requirements. It's a zero lot line, zero setback district, mixed-use district. And presently, front yards are specifically prohibited, unless you're using them for a plaza or an outdoor dining activity. We felt that this was too restrictive. Front yards are still discouraged in this district. However, we felt that removing that one sentence will allow for more flexibility for developers. So very simple.
Okay, thank you, Kevin. I see Debbie's back there, so she's giving you mentoring opportunity tonight. Is that correct? Gotcha. All right.
I have one question,
yes.
Kevin. This was there originally to establish a flat storefront area,
yes.
Correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, down City Hall Avenue and throughout really the Village Commercial portion of the Big Woods. However, we do have two developments now, this building and formerly Dr. Savilla's building out at the corner that have been developed with a front yard, and the Fountains of Pocosin, which is currently in the development phase, that will have a front yard area.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much. All right. Unless council has any objection, I'm going to open the public hearing. I don't think anybody does. All right. Open the public hearing and ask for comments. If anybody has any particular concerns or support or against this change to the Village Commercial District. Okay, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and ask for consideration by council.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt an ordinance amending the zoning ordinance by revising Article 11, Village Commercial District pertaining to front yards.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded that we adopt the ordinance. Questions or comments? Judy, please.
Vice Mayor Freeman?
Aye.
Councilman Bernal?
Aye.
Councilman Green?
Aye.
Councilman Ayer?
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford?
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt?
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, now we are out of the public hearings and we're on to new business. The first item under new business is a community-based sport designation request for Islander Soccer Association. Who's going to give this?
Mr. Mayor, Ms. Callis will present on behalf of the staff. Gretchen's also here. Essentially, this is the first of its kind that you've seen as a constituted council. It's an evolution of a process that is many years old, and it comes to you in a slightly new form or format because it's been more than 15 years since there's been a designation of a community-based sports organization. Dave and Gretchen have worked hard, and that process of work continues where we're learning how to do this. We're constantly trying to weigh what's really important to make sure as a requirement, as opposed to when do we have more process in our way than there is public good associated. So we're not finished, and we appreciate ISA going through this process with us and providing their comments through it. I think we've got one more iteration in the future, but we didn't want to slow them up while we're doing that. The ISA and Dave will speak to it, and there are representatives from ISA here, but they've done a very nice job both in their preparation going through our process, but equally or more important, of starting from scratch a new program, which is really an outreach of an existing program based out of Williamsburg for young people to have a travel soccer opportunity that is based here, open to all, but based here. And with that, Dave, I'll let you summarize the process and what this is and how you get it, who else has it, what your recommendation
is. Very good, sir. Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Hunt, members of council. The Islander Soccer Association organization is comprised of 14 soccer teams, totaling approximately 204 participants, 94 of those from Pocosin. Bill and others from the ISA are here tonight, and I'm sure they'll be pleased to speak at council's discretion. It is anticipated that the number of Pocosin participants will increase in the future beyond the 94 as ISA grows in the community. Upon review of the submission, staff's recommending approval and inclusion of ISA as a community-based sports group. Should City Council approve the application, ISA will receive the following. One, a field and facility schedule of $10 per child for Pocosin residents and $20 per child for non-residents per season, fall and spring, for instance. Second, third-tier priority scheduling, along with other community-based sports groups, for practices and for games following Pocosin City Public Schools and Parks and Recreation scheduling requirements. As a point of reference, the city's existing community sports groups, American Legion, Pocosin Little League, Back River Youth Sports, and Pocosin Youth Football and Cheerleading, currently receive the aforementioned opportunities as well. The four groups are recognized by name in the City Public Schools City of Pocosin Field Use Agreement, which was established in 1998. Based on their 15-year history in the field use agreement, their quality programming efforts, and their community focus, along with their insurance certifications and incorporated status, these groups have been grandfathered and have not been asked to provide a community-based sports application. Islander Soccer Association represents the first sports organization to submit an application for a community-based sports group designation, and I would submit they've done a very thorough job, and we thank Bill and his group for working so diligently with us. As the city manager spoke to, our opportunity to work with ISA in this initial effort has highlighted the need for further refinement of the application. Pursuant to this, staff will continue to revise and streamline it, ensuring the document and process are clear and concise for sports organizations who seek to apply for the status. Subsequent to this revision, it's our intent to bring the draft back to City Council for review and input prior to implementation. Again, ISA is here to provide additional information, and we're pleased to answer any questions. Thank you.
Questions of council?
I have. I know I've given you some feedback online previously about some of the stuff that I had asked information about. But is there do we have a document that outlines the benefits of receiving the designation of community? Community, whatever we're calling them, base sport.
We do not, other than what's referenced in the cover memo for council.
Those are the only two benefits?
Those are the preponderance, the greatest benefits they would receive. The priority scheduling is very important for groups, for larger groups of this size, and the constant fee of $10 or $20 for non-resident are also the largest benefits.
Okay. I had some other comments, too, that I can get to you later about the checklist.
Yes, ma'am. For the information of the public here, I mean, we're using public fields for private organizations. Is there, within your guidelines, is there a minimum percentage of Pocosin residents that need to be engaged? I guess I'm just a little fearful, not of this particular application, but longer term, that what we don't want to do is run out of sports facilities while we have recognized sports facilities coming, sports teams coming from out of the area, getting this designation, then getting priority scheduling for our fields. So I want to make sure that in the longer term, there's probably a minimum percentage. I'm not saying it has to be 100%. I'm not saying it has to be in the high 90s. And I'm not even going to give you a percentage here, just that we have that thought process in and basically a guideline, because we want to serve Pocosin first.
Mr. Mayor, right? Very good point.
And
yes, sir.
Understand that a certain percentage may be from out of the city. Get that. No issue with that. I just don't want it to be primarily Hampton organization that because of field space has signed up and says, hey, we can do this in Pocosin, use their field.
Okay? Yes, sir. We will definitely take care of that.
All right. Any other concerns or questions by council on this?
Just a similar question, not dealing specifically with where the folks are coming from, but how is the overall availability of fields with all the activities that go on? I know that's always been a little tight, shall we say.
Yes, sir. That question very much on point. And I would defer to Gretchen for specific scheduling percentages, but I will tell you that our fields are busy and well used by a very active community. I would also add that ISA's initial request, the preponderance of their request for games will be on Sundays, where we have substantial availability.
Thank you.
Okay. No, it's okay. I was just taken back by your reaction when he said that Gretchen was going to handle that question.
There were two requests that were part of the application that included field requests. It both included games on Sundays at various locations or based on availability, as well as 5-day-a-week usage for practice locations or a field in the city of varying sizes. I can tell you that Sunday afternoons or Sunday time at South Lawson is highly available. There could be some scheduling conflicts related to turf use. As you know, the priority list for usage is the high school Parks and Rec activities and then groups behind that. There is currently rain makeup schedules that are in place for youth football that is part of their agreements currently. We don't want to circumvent any of those arrangements in this application, but we have been forthcoming with the group that things are limited and they've been seeking space in other localities as well, not just here, to understand that things are limited, but this designation may be a financial plus for them instead of paying on a by-hour basis for every hour that they are able to utilize that we have available. So that's really one of the real perks, since you were talking about the perks, that is it more economical? And if their hours tend to be less than their actual per head fee, then certainly I'm sure we'll be able to work with them on that in that regard. Yep. Any other questions about scheduling?
No, that's
okay. Okay, sure.
You didn't have to come and tell us that one, but I, all right, I just want to, like I said, I'm only concerned about percentage of residents, make sure that our facilities that the taxpayers all basically pay for are available to residents, first and foremost, and this seems to aid that. The other thing I would ask y'all to consider is that you account for this money so that we know, you know, are you breaking even on this endeavor, and you know, or getting close, or allowing us to put money into other facilities with a portion of it. So hard questions, and not asking for answers tonight, but just make sure that we're considering that, because if we get five or six of these, or how many sports designations can you take? Let's say that you've now got four originals and now five. So what if it went to eight? You know, or do you have a maximum limit where you say for sports organizations you're full up? So for a particular field type or a gym type. So just don't get us overloaded and hurt feelings. And so just please watch those couple items if you would. All right. On this particular request, what does council need to do here?
Mr. Mayor, at your place, if you choose to want to move forward, there is a resolution to that effect that was at your place.
Okay.
To approve community designation for ISA.
Okay.
All
right. Mr. Mayor, I'd like to move that we adopt a resolution designating the Islander Soccer Association as a community-based sports organization.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded that we approve the resolution for the Islander Soccer Association as a community-based sports organization. Questions or comments? Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay. Thank you very much, and welcome to the Islander Soccer as a partner with us, and look forward to all working together. So, and thank you for teaching us about our new process. We do appreciate it. I know that it sounds in jest, but I'm sure it was a lot more work and a lot more feedback. So appreciate staff's time as well, Dave and Gretchen. I'm sure this was not easy to come through, but I agree it's a long-term benefit. So thank you for that. Okay, next item on under new business is a request by Port Messick LLC for an 18-month extension of its lease purchase agreement with the City of Pecosin for property at 413 Messick Road. And this is tax map parcel 40, tag 01, tag 00, tag 0003A.
Mr. Mayor, as you correctly pointed out, this is the request for a second addendum to that lease. There are five areas of amendment that would be part of the addendum. The first is it would extend the term of the option agreement. Currently, we operate under a lease purchase type agreement. The term of that ends at the end of this calendar year, so that would extend by 18 months that term. During that 18 months, the amount of monthly rent, which is currently $1,100 per month, would increase to $1,200 per month during the 18-month extension period. Three, it would add as a condition, as an additional condition to qualify for purchase of the purchase option, that the Port Messick establish electric and water service to a minimum of 6 boat slips at the city pier. That may already be in. I saw some pictures today of power pedestals. So if that's not completely in, that is very short in terms of turnaround. Lastly, I guess I said there was five, it's really in four, that as we continue to look for a longer term project of a breakwater out at Messick Point, that in this agreement, we've been asked to consider a reimbursement to Port Messick for up to $5,000 towards the cost of design and appropriate permitting of a breakwater. The only condition to that, other than be it professionally engineered and approvable by the Corps, is that upon reimbursement that we have the unrestricted ownership of that, the ability to use it without anyone else's permission as the principal payer. Mr. Moses is here, and he may wish to speak to the issue, but this is part and parcel with what we talked about, and I think we're all good. And I would take a moment to point out to you, if you haven't been to Messick Point in a few weeks, you haven't seen the completion of the bait and tackle shop, that is it. Mr. Moses began his operation last Thursday, and full-service bait and tackle shop with more stuff to come, and a restaurant in close proximity on this property before too long, we hope. And Bob has worked diligently through that process of approval too. And this extension is really designed to help facilitate that primarily.
Okay. Is there any council okay with this, or do you need to hear from Bob?
I just want to ask a question that's not really related so much to this. Right, when do you propose?
Let him come up there.
Oh, okay. Hey, Bob. About when do you think that you may have fuel down there?
The fuel, we're still having to work, revisit. When we were looking at the fuel dock, we had a different design and location for the building, which would keep it a safe distance from that. And that's what led to the approval of the fuel dock. In January, we became for the BZA to get permission to place that building within the 50-foot RPA, and it was denied. So that's what's led to having to reconstitute the site plan, break apart that nice big building that we did have a lot of support from staff to develop. And it's led to the marina store being put where the bait and tackle being put where it is. The restaurant now has to go into the center of the property. It puts it within that danger zone of the approved fire or fuel pier. So we're still looking at that. And that was only approved for diesel. So that's still fluid, so to speak.
I was just curious, and it really doesn't have anything to do with this particular proposal, but I know the public was interested in that.
Yeah, and I would like very much to move forward on that if that location for the fuel dock is still going to be permitted. So we'll look at that after the restaurant's examined by staff.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I have a question on basically what we've got here in the packet. I've got the resolution on top, and I have an addendum to the option agreement. Item section 1C and the addendum basically on section 4 kind of says two different things about the plans. Again, what I believe that the city of Pocosin is trying to do is to partner for Bob to get an approved plan for the breakwater, and that if the lease is broken for some reason, that we would own the plan if that was to occur, so that we could do it unilaterally. Do those two, in other words, if we approve this resolution, does this addendum go with it? Is that what we're...
If you approve this resolution, then you'll empower me to sign this addendum. And the addendum has that specific language in it.
The thing that concerns me is that C in the resolution doesn't match the addendum.
Okay.
The language in the addendum. Then the question would be, which one controls, the resolution or the addendum? That would be the only concern I had on this.
So in any motion that we get, could somebody be specific in saying that we change the language in section 1C to agree with the addendum language pertaining to section C? And I think that would...
Could we just
Wayne,
strike
do you agree?
Section C and allow the addendum to control?
It's item 4 in the...
Addendum,
right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Then why don't we just say in item C that agree with item 4 in the addendum?
You don't need either A, B, or C in this resolution.
Right.
You can authorize the city manager to sign the attached agreement.
I like that.
Which covers all of the conditions.
I like
and
that.
You
I
can just leave A, B, and C out of the resolution altogether because everything is covered in the addendum.
Okay. I like that.
Better.
All right. We like simple.
Well, we would have gotten that straight, except I was off goofing off last week.
All right. Is there a motion?
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution approving an 18-month extension of the lease purchase agreement between the City of Pocosin and Port Messick LLC for the property at 413 Messick Road, and delete items A through C.
Second. And renumber section 2 to section 1.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. No, you don't. You don't have to renumber it. You're right.
No. Okay, motion made and seconded that we approve the resolution. Questions or comments? Seeing none, Judy, please.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay. The next item under new business is award of a contract for fire department medic unit and appropriation of grant funds. Who would like to speak to this?
I'll introduce it, and then I'll invite the chief, the other chief, the chief behind him, the chief next to him who's still
here. There's a lot of chiefs
in there. Or Battalion Chief Young, anyone or all of them. As is often the case, and we are always a beneficiary of having an outstanding volunteer fire and rescue organizations, two organizations. They work hand in hand with each other, and they work hand in hand with us. And the item before you tonight is the approval authorization to allow me to execute on behalf of the city a contract to purchase an ambulance, an EMS vehicle, a committee from volunteer fire rescue, and our own folks have worked together to spec this. They know exactly what it should be, and they're in agreement on what it is. Approximately, slightly less than half of the money comes from the state of Virginia in the form of the grant. And the balance, $83,737, comes from the volunteer rescue squad. This is just another example of good partnership. Which one of the five of you would like to come up and fill in anything that I've missed?
He's the most junior person back there. Oh, that's
not
him. Not
most junior,
that's
but he was
him.
Closest to the podium.
So does this mean we got five chiefs and no Indians?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Sure hope there's no fire tonight.
Exactly right. I'll be glad to answer any questions that you might have.
What I got out of that was y'all have a fully specced out ambulance that the volunteer fire department is willing to help us pay for or pay for in total. And we're thrilled to have that.
Yeah, we are. Yeah. We had the opportunity to set up a committee and work together, and I think we did a real good job and able to provide a medic unit with no city funds. So I think that's
All right.
It's a good thing.
Well, and I appreciate you coming up, Chief Holloway. I want the chief from the volunteer fire rescue squad to come up here.
You lose.
The only reason I ask him to come up here is because As Randy eloquently stated, and I love the writing and all the stuff that are on your units, and I want to make sure that everybody in Pocosin understands that this is really what Pocosin is all about, and that it basically called out on your trucks, and that is volunteer and career working together.
We put it on everything we own.
And I appreciate, and the citizens of Pocosin appreciate what the volunteers do in aiding us for that. And I'm sure that Chief Holloway can echo those comments, because we wouldn't be half the department that we are without the volunteers.
Exactly.
But that is not taking anything away from the professionals that do it every day.
We value that relationship very much.
Okay. Thank you very much. And if y'all have some extra money, could you let Chief Bowen have some for a police car?
Keep him whistling.
Okay. I'm sure I'll have no problem finding a motion on this one.
Oh, sure. Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract with Northwest Emergency Vehicles for purchase of a medic unit.
Second.
Motion made and seconded that we appropriate those funds via this ordinance. Questions or comments? Judy, please.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Thank you very much.
And Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt an ordinance making additional appropriations for fiscal year 2013-14.
Second.
Motion made and seconded that we approve the accompanying ordinance. Judy, please.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
All right, next item under new business is a resolution authorizing the receipt of bids for lease of a publicly owned property located in the Big Woods. That would be tax map parcel 27, tac 1, tac 1, which I believe was also the subject of the rezone of the conditional use request earlier in the evening. So,
Mr. Mayor, members of council, this is in fact the parcel that was referenced, and it was the subject of the approved conditional use permit for the laser tag. If you recall from that application, which was in your package, it was actually a note from me that said contingent upon an approved agreement with the city council. Mr. Drummond has expressed a desire to enter into a lease and or purchase agreement with the city. What this does under the city charter, in order to actively consider and potentially award or sell or long-term lease this property, you need to go through a public process. A public process that allows other people to come forward and also make offers on the property, as well as an opportunity to speak on the issue generally. So what this does, and consistent with the process that you followed with Fort Park Street and also with Port Mesa, this would begin that process. If you approve it between now and your next meeting on August the 12th, we will advertise that. We will augment that by putting it out on our Facebook and our Twitter and our website and our TV channel for some additional outreach. And then during that period up to and right before the meeting starts, any party that would like to make a formal bid on that process can do so by sealed bid. They would submit that to our office, to Judy Wiggins specifically. Then, assuming again that you approve this, we will open all the bids that we get that night at the council meeting. We will summarize them for anyone that's here, provide an opportunity for the public, and then if you follow the process that you have in the last two times that you've dealt with this, then you would table for a month to allow any other comments that might, not bids, but any other comments. You don't have to follow that process, but that's the process you have used the last two. And with that, I'll stop talking. We'll try to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay. Do you have questions of the city manager? Board. Okay. So is there a motion on the resolution?
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution of the Council of the City of Pocosin, Virginia, directing that public notice be given of the Council's intention to receive bids for lease purchase of publicly owned property located in the Big Woods, known as Tax Map Parcel 27-01-00-0001.
Second. Okay, motion made and seconded we adopt the resolution. Questions or comments? Judy, please.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay. Next item under new business is an ordinance making additional appropriations and transfers for fiscal year 2013 and 2014.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, you will recall a couple of months ago you gave final authorization to move forward following a public process, just like the one we just discussed, to sell Fort Park Street. That was closed upon on June 5th, and our net proceeds of that sale were $74,413. And what this action before you would do is to appropriate that money and move it to the EDA for two express purposes. One, the $25,000 of that amount be specifically set aside for the first of the three installments on the economic development agreement recently approved by council with Pocosin Family Practice. Second, that the remaining money, which is $49,413, specifically be used for principal repayment to essentially pay, to accelerate the payment of the principal on the loan that you recently took out in support of the EDA.
Anybody prepared to make a motion on this ordinance?
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt an ordinance making additional appropriations for fiscal year 2013-14.
Second.
Motion made and seconded that we approve this ordinance. Questions or comments? Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Abstain.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 5-0 with one abstention.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, let's see. Next item is a resolution amending the city's health care flexible spending account plan. And if you want, I'll even give you the short. You want to increase it from 2,500 to 3,000?
Actually, it goes the other way.
3,000 to 2,500. Oh, I'm sorry.
Current federal law permits us to set a standard of up to 5,000. Well, I say current. Most recent federal law, but with the changes most recently made through the Affordable Care Act, they actually drops that number down to 2,500. So the standard, you can set a number less than that, but you can't set a number more than that. And so we need to bring our policy limit or our deduction limit down from 3,000 to 2,500. We're in no way experts on the Affordable Care Act, but I believe this has something to do with the advent of the health savings accounts as well. There are other ways to get at this.
Look, I'm not gonna go so far as to say that this just increased your basically a flexible spending account allows the federal government to help you fund your flexible spending account. And that by them requiring it and then reducing the amount means that you will pay more for it.
Right.
Is that correct?
Right.
I got that. I wanted to make sure.
I think when they named this thing, they left the UN off of affordable. It should be unaffordable act.
All right. With that said, and our local government flavor on the federal government, I'll take a motion that we approve this if somebody is so willing.
Mr. Mayor, I reluctantly move that we adopt a resolution amending the City of Pocosin Health Care Flexible Spending Account Plan.
Is there a second?
Second, just to keep us in conformance with federal law.
Okay. Do you want all those words in the minutes?
No. No.
Okay. If not, I'm not even going to ask for questions or comments. This is a housekeeping item. And Judy, please.
Councilwoman Crawford?
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, thank you very much. And the last item this evening, and that's why we kept the police chief so long, is a discussion of the proposed gun ordinance amendments. And Randy?
Mr. Mayor, first let me say that unlike the other items on your new business, this is styled simply for discussion. We wanted to make sure that before we finally advanced this to discussion that we had dealt with the issues that that you all were concerned about. If I can go back in time a little bit, we had been contacted on more than one occasion, and this is not unique to Pocosin. Anytime that there is a conflict between local gun ordinances or anything related to guns and the state law, there are folks that will alert us to that. Appreciate that. We have a hard time keeping up with the number of changes that that they deal with at the state level. They deal with a number of important issues, and every year there are many changes. So the minute they change it, then our old ordinance that was compliant yesterday is no longer compliant. And I have to say that both police chief and Wayne Moore and Lisa Moore did a really excellent job of trying to update our ordinance to reflect the current language on all of the pertinent issues. And then we took a moment and we stopped and we said, you know, this is really only going to be as good until the General Assembly goes back into session. Maybe we should take a different tack. So what you'll see in almost every aspect of this ordinance, which if you took out the removed items, are actually much, much smaller. but I'll just use the one, if you would turn with me like this, to the third page of the ordinance, section 54-205. What you find in place of extensive explanations or regurgitation of this current state law, you find more simplified statements, which basically says it shall be unlawful to furnish weapons to minors in the city of Pecosin in violation of section 18.2-309 of the Code of Virginia. That is the state code of Virginia, and as long as they make changes within that code section, which deals with this, we're automatically going to be current. And the reason to have our own section is not that we ever want to write under these ordinances, but if we do, the fines and other things that go to support the work of the people that enforce that come back to us. We write under the state section. We do the same amount of work, but the state gets all the remuneration. And of course, we're not in the remuneration business, but we're also not in giving the state a check for the work that we're doing. So what we attempted to do is to go through, and in each case we could grab the code section and say we're gonna comply with that. The only significant sections that continue to exist that are not in that format are they look new because of the way that they're put in here. That's section 54-202, and because it was a new section number, it's put in here as an add. But you will find those same things in the original version, section 54-206. So at that point, I'll stop talking, defer to the chief, defer to Mr. Moore, whose office prepared this draft. And I think we're going in the right direction. But before we brought it to you for a vote, we wanted to make sure so that we only had to do this hopefully.
So you're not looking for a vote tonight?
No, just a sense, or are we going in the right direction?
Okay.
I have a comment.
Well, hold on. Chief, have you got anything that you'd like to add?
Thank the city manager for the great job in covering the issue, but basically, unless they change the number of the state code, we won't have to change these anymore. We're just adopting the state code on those specific topics. Simplifies the whole process.
Right.
And keeps us from having to keep reviewing these on a regular basis so we don't get behind like we were. And I would say this in addition to what the city manager did say about some of the local ordinances that were out of line. We'd even run these by the previous Commonwealth attorney and gotten an opinion on several of them, and she had told us, as did the city attorney, that they were not even enforceable. So this needed to be done. We needed to get this done quickly and communicate it to the community, and I think this does that. So I recommend we proceed with the recommendations from the city attorney. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. I was just going to say that I believe those three people that you mentioned, or that Randy mentioned, just did a super job.
Yes.
Rewriting this.
I agree. And so basically this keeps us aligned with state code, and there's only three things that are Pecosin specific in here, right?
Yes, you'll see a couple of where there are
4202.
Yeah, there are a couple of code sections that are written in the state code that starts off by saying local governing bodies may adopt.
Right.
When it does that, we can choose to participate or not to.
Okay.
And then the other ones say local, you know, that you shall do certain things. For example, the code section on concealed weapons has just gone totally
and it's
changed through the last 10 years, and so that will continue to happen. But we have adopted a couple of those that give us an option to participate, and I think the 54.207 is a perfect example where we may adopt an ordinance to deal with hunting with firearms and trapping generally, and we say that we're going to do that there, and that's specifically talking about distances from roadways and that sort of thing.
Okay.
So I think it's just keeping consistent with the state code.
Okay.
Is the right way to go and gives us guidance on how we'll enforce the law.
I agree. It's a yearly battle at the state level, and we really don't have the jurisdiction except for as allowed by the state.
Yes.
Is council okay with this approach first?
The approach, yeah.
I didn't see any, may have missed it, but I didn't see any reference to presence of firearms on school property. That I believe is still limited.
That's covered in the 308 section of the Code of Virginia.
Okay.
As well as there is a section in here about places of religious worship, which
I
is a specific
worship,
case.
But I didn't see schools.
Yes, but the schools, there is a separate state ordinance that covers where schools are mentioned.
Should that be in our ordinance, reference to it?
Yeah, we adopt the entire code section 18.2-308,
okay,
which is the concealed weapons.
If you look at 308, it covers all those various issues.
And all the subsections.
Set them all out, we just adopted the whole code.
Yeah, it's pages long now, with the subsections, it's pages long.
And I had, having said, overall, I think you just did a super job. Under definitions on rifle, we define a semi-automatic. We don't define automatic weapons in there at all. We say single projectile each time you pull a trigger through a rifle bore. And did we intend to do that? I guess is my question there. And then over on section 54203, we say it's unlawful to carry a dangerous weapon. What's a dangerous weapon?
And that's wording from the code of Virginia. So the 283 specifically says, if any person carry any gun, pistol, Bowie knife, dagger, so it includes all the other weapons other than just firearms.
Under 203, you're talking about 54203?
Yeah, the code of Virginia.
Dangerous in religious worship. We say it's unlawful to carry a dangerous weapon. And then I didn't see a definition of what is a dangerous weapon.
It says as defined.
As defined by the state.
It's as defined by the state.
Oh, okay.
But under 283, it talks about, it's actually 283 in the Code of Virginia. It's adopted, and that does define it. It says any person carrying a gun, pistol, Bowie knife, dagger, or other dangerous weapon without good and sufficient reasons to a place of worship, while a meeting for religious purposes is being held, is guilty of a class 4 misdemeanor. That's what we are adopting by that language.
Okay.
And any future change.
Whether we adopt it or not, it's still the state law.
Yeah, it's still state code.
Right. Okay.
We could charge it under a local ordinance if we choose to.
All right. So what I heard was a consensus of council that you're heading in the right direction.
I have some questions about it.
Are they specific
yes.
to this or
yes.
about the what we've been asked tonight, which is the direction that they're heading? In other words, can you give your comments to them for specific... We're not approving tonight any ordinances.
I just wanted to publicly say a couple of things. When we define pneumatic gun, while nail gun is not listed there, a nail gun is a pneumatic gun. So I want to be careful to allow construction people to build with pneumatic guns. When we, turning the page to 54202A,
I missed what you said.
I'm sorry?
I got the first book. Then after
204
pneumatic gun, where'd you say? I missed what your code section was.
That was just the definition for pneumatic gun.
I got that. Then what was the next thing you said?
The next one is the second page, 54202A. It shall be unlawful for any person to discharge a pneumatic gun from all these different places. I would like to discuss whether we want that in there, because that's not allowing boys to play with BB guns or paintball guns or pellet guns, or some people I know who need to shoot at some varmints from, you know, I know we've got some of those river, whatever they, Nutri or whatever. I don't like that particular one. Then moving over.
I think that it's not prohibiting it completely. It says across or toward or within 300 yards of a paved public street.
Right, but if I'm on my back porch and I want to shoot, I've got a football field behind me that's mine. And if I want to shoot a BB gun off my porch towards the target or something, or a paintball gun, or my boys want to play paintball, not shooting towards the house, but they, you know, shooting away from the house, I don't know why we would want to disallow that.
They can travel. It's all they have to do with safety. They can travel a very long distance, ricochet, and penetrate the building and penetrate the soft material that some of these houses are made out of.
Oh, I understand it's all about safety, but I'm not in the business of giving up civil liberties for safety. And I feel very strongly about that. Moving on to the next page, 54203, which we just discussed about carrying a dangerous weapon. Not to mention, you know, what it defined dangerous, but that means that people can't, does that, if I have a concealed carry permit, would that mean I couldn't carry it to church?
Yeah. Unless there's a waiver under the other section that says it doesn't apply, yes, it would mean
that. Okay, then I don't like that one either. I think people should be allowed to.
That's state code. is what I'm...
I don't think so.
It is.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
As defined in...
18.2-283, and the state code prohibits it already.
If the state code... The state code will trump whatever we write.
Right, I understand.
Okay? So the state code does not allow you to carry a dangerous weapon into a place of worship or school.
Right.
Then no matter what we write,
right,
you cannot do that. And what they're saying is that this is probably one of the most... how many pages in the code is that?
Right.
30?
It's a book.
Yeah. It's a bunch.
Yeah.
And there's ins and outs that... I think what they're saying is we don't want to try and interpret the ins and outs. We'll let the state code of Virginia do that.
Okay.
I think any comments?
I agree with that. I definitely...
It does say without good and sufficient reason in the state code. So it doesn't mean that there aren't circumstances under which someone could possess a firearm, but there's a standard that a judge would have to hear that.
So I'm still going to go to court. Is what you're saying.
It would just depend on how that would be interpreted. It would be a magistrate would have to hear evidence to determine there was probable cause to believe that this was violated using the standard of without good and sufficient reason.
I just see us, our civil liberties are eroding, and it makes me crazy.
You're going to have to go to court to get a carry permit anyway.
I read that code today. There's a bunch of things you can carry. I mean, it breaks it down. If you read that code, 18.2.283, I read it today.
Okay.
And it tells you some of the things you can do if you have a concealed weapon permit.
Right.
Okay. And finally, I guess to say this, when we phrase this, it shall be unlawful to do X, Y, or Z in violation of section whatever of the Code of Virginia. It might be better to phrase it, remove the in violate the section whatever, and simply put that in parentheses at the end, so that the statement is it shall be unlawful to furnish whatever or to do whatever. Make the statement by itself, because that way if the code does change or the section does change, we haven't tied the section to the rule.
Well, that's exactly what we are doing, because that's how we got in trouble before.
Okay.
We had several local ordinances that were basically unenforceable because we had put specific language in there and the state code changed. What this does, this now puts us in line with the state code, so when the state code changes, we don't have to go back and rechange our local ordinance.
But the state code, when it changes, it will also change the sections.
No, not necessarily. They can change a specific, they can change 18.2-283 and make it read something else.
Okay.
It won't get another number.
We're hoping, basically, that they won't add enough laws in there that the sections change and we'll always...
If they add an additional number, which is a new law, and it's something that we have the option of adopting, then we could adopt that ordinance. But right now, the topic of carrying dangerous weapons in the place of worship will remain 18.2-283, whether they change it or add language to it or not.
Okay. And then I just had a question. 54207, hunting with firearms. It shall be unlawful to hunt in Pocosin. We have duck hunters, and we have people who do hunt deer.
But in violation of section 29.1-526. And what that says, you have to go to the state code, and what that says, it gives you distances. It says the county or governing body may prohibit by ordinance hunting with a firearm or any game bird or game animal or trapping within 100 yards of any primary or secondary highway in such county or city, and may provide that the violation that is class 3 misdemeanor, and it goes on with the paragraph. So what we're just doing is we're adopting this, which is already in state law. And if they change this, we're still good. So we got it written.
And if we don't adopt this to agree with state law, that doesn't mean that state law is not enforceable.
It doesn't mean it's not enforceable. In this case, where it says the governing body may, then this would not be a violation of our local ordinance. This would not be a violation because we, in this case, the General Assembly has said we may adopt an ordinance that says this is illegal. We don't have to.
So we don't have to adopt an ordinance saying it's unlawful to hunt in Pocosin?
Well, we're not saying it's unlawful to hunt. We're saying the conditions that you hunt may be unlawful. In other words,
I'll talk to you
later. Otherwise,
you got to follow the conditions.
I'd be more happy to send you the code section.
Yeah, I was concerned about that too. It's not saying you can't hunt in Pocosin.
Correct.
It's saying you've got to hunt 100 yards away from
a
state highway. Correct.
Yes, right. You have to be in compliance with that section.
That I'm fine with.
How you hunt in Pocosin is defined by 29.1-526, and that's what you have to read to see.
Right.
To get the rules. And that's what I wanted to clarify. Thank you.
Chief, just one simple question. Has anybody ever come to the police station, or where do they get the I mean, you're right. State code changes just about yearly from the political. And do they ever come, do citizens ever come looking for what's the current law on this, what's the current law on that?
Yes, they do. Actually, I purchase, using my budget funds, new versions of the state code on the most used sections for the supervisors.
Okay.
Every year. It's a pretty big expense, but because they change, we also get a document, a CD from the state police, where there is a instructional video which goes over all the major changes, and then the Commonwealth Attorneys Association produces a similar PowerPoint presentation that we do. We make it available to our guys too, so they get basically a legal update.
How about the citizens themselves?
We do get questions. They'll call.
Do we have like a handout that says, "Hey, here's what the current state standards are"?
It wouldn't be a handout. It would be a book.
I don't want to get more like online. More like the PowerPoint presentation of what the changes are.
It would be a book, but we could.
You can consider that. I'm not saying go do that. I'm certainly not saying that. I'm just asking. Change it quite a bit.
Yeah, we keep updated code books available. If somebody wants to look at them or they ask us a question, I get calls directly to my office. I get people stop by, and that does happen. And that's why we give it to our supervisors and our officers so they can answer those legal questions the citizens have.
Thank you very much. Anything else from council? Okay. Again, we've got a consensus to proceed and bring it back to us at a future date. And now we're on to comments of the city manager.
Don't have anything, sir.
Okay. Council directives. Councilman Bernal, we'll start down.
Just very briefly, certainly impressive with the work that staff did in preparation for this meeting. It was a plethora of items there that needed to be addressed, and they did a thorough job, and that certainly made our job easier to understand and to take the actions that we did. So appreciate that, and also the certainly congratulate the volunteer firemen and those who wrote the grant, and the fact that we are now on our way to another piece of fine equipment.
Okay, thank you very much. Councilman Green.
Just to thank the Lions Club for last month hosting the food bank drive, and to thank Ed and Sherry Harper for having the Lions do a separate drive. They brought 80-some bags of protein, peanut butter, canned meats, and a canned vegetable, anticipating that we were going to run out of food again. We did, and thanks to the Lions Club, we were able to serve just as many people with their donations as we did with the USDA food. Okay. And to remind everybody that since we don't have a second meeting this month, the food bank will be on the 23rd of July. St. Timothy's Church is hosting it, and we're changing the hours now from 10 to 1.
Still at the same location?
Still at the same location, the old municipal building.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you very much. Councilman Eric.
Yeah, just wanted to say tonight it was nice to have such a packed house. Everyone should get involved in local government. We had a lot of different views and issues tonight. A lot of folks showed up, so that was great. I want to thank the Kiwanis for putting out the flags July the 4th. And on July the 4th, I happened to stop at three Pocosin businesses, two of them brand new. Got me some bait at Captain Harold's, stopped at the outdoor shop and got me some more bait, and stopped at the marina down at Pocosin and got me some more bait. Didn't catch a lot of fish, but I got a lot of bait. A lot of places, and it's nice to have these businesses opening up. I mean, we're a community that of watermen and outdoorsmen, and you see a lot of these things happen, and it's good to see it. And spend your dollars here local. It means a lot to these businesses. Also, just to the city staff and preparing all these documents. Just phenomenal job. You always do. And we appreciate it. Thank you. Makes our job much easier.
Councilwoman Crawford.
I just wanted to publicly thank the Island Soccer Association. I know it might have felt like we were putting up barriers to you, when in fact we were just trying to create a process that was helpful. So I also apologize if it was more difficult than it might have needed to have been. But I appreciate your persistence, and I'm very glad we were able to get the outcome we all wanted.
Thanks, Mayor.
I don't have anything additional. My same old story. As recently as yesterday, people were telling me what a great job city agencies do for people in the community. So I'd like to keep bringing that up, even though it's kind of old. It never gets old, really, that our staff just does such a good job. That's all I have.
Thank you very much. I have no further comments this evening. So I think we've been here pretty good amount of time, moved through the agenda pretty quickly. No closed session, thank you. Thank you, Judy. All right, and so I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So move, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
A motion made and seconded, we adjourn. Judy, please.
Councilwoman Crawford.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
And we are adjourned.
Mr. Willis.